Thanks. Thanks for coming.
My pleasure.
He's in The Real Thing on Broadway. He's fabulous. I hope you can go see it. When does it close, Josh?
January 4th.
So you have a little time.
A month.
You know, we have something in common. I always like to start the interview. Jonathan Mark Sherman, you were in...
Yeah.
What was
Women in Wallace was
so
his first play that I
did. The first reading of it that James Lapine directed.
Oh, yeah.
A long time ago.
For the Young Playwrights Festival.
Yes.
Yeah.
I played the mother that commits suicide.
Right. Of course. Yeah, yeah. Right.
It's such a good play.
It's a beautiful play. Yeah. It was a formative experience for me because he was... Do you know the... I guess they still have the Young Playwrights Festival, do they?
I don't know.
I don't know if they still have it. It used to be this really big thing where they would have... You had to be under 18 and playwrights would get... New York professional writers and directors, I mean actors and directors, to be in their plays, and it was some of the best. It was so fun.
It was.
And this beautiful play called Women in Wallace that Jonathan Mark Sherman wrote when he was like 16, 17. I think I was 18.
And you played him.
And I played him.
And I played the mother who commits suicide.
Yeah,
She keeps committing suicide throughout the whole play.
Well, it was based on his real mother who committed suicide when he was like six, and it was about his relationships with women over the next, from that age until like 18, and we went on from, you know, he's still one of my best friends, and we had a theater company together when we were in our 20s.
Was that the Malapart?
Yeah, yeah.
Now, what? How'd you get that name?
Ethan, it was.
Tell me who was in the company.
It was started by Jonathan Mark Sherman and Ethan Hawke and myself. And we had, when we were like maybe 20 or 21, we'd gone on a cross-country trip and had this idea for, we were tired of waiting around for people to hire us. We said, well, why don't we do our own plays?
Right.
And it was mostly Ethan because he was really the kind of, he had that kind of energy. He was like, let's put on a, he just wanted to do it. And he came up with a name, and it was based on the name of an Italian novel that was published without binding, so you could read it in any order. It was more about the experience of reading than the plot. I mean, it could not have been a more pretentious name. And everyone, I mean, our friends mercilessly, it was variously known as Marlboro, the Marlboro Company, Malamar. It was like people loved to like give it other names. And it only lasted for a few years, but then
Did you do new plays?
Well, our idea was to do a combination of new plays and revivals that we wanted to do, but we tried to do a number of revivals, but we never got the rights. The plays we wanted to do, there was always some like upcoming Broadway production, and they didn't want to give us the rights to do it, so we ended up doing just new plays.
Well, that's good.
Yeah. Yeah, but you know, it's harder to come up with good new plays.
What do you know now, Josh, that you wish you knew then?
Oh, that's a good question.
Oh, good.
I've always gotten like worked well with, or felt like I wanted to be directed. I've always liked a lot of direction.
Yes.
But, and sometimes I wish that I had even more so trusted a director and like done whatever they wanted and
really?
Whatever they want. Yeah. Yeah.
Because on
very few occasions, and it's happened very rarely where I've either have wondered about the, like, I don't know if I get this director, what he's trying to do, and I've sort of been like, oh, I'm gonna do my own thing, and then ultimately found out that you can't. It's better to just go along, even if it doesn't work. It's better to
try it
because you're ultimately you are in their production, and so if you're somehow trying to like stand outside of it,
right.
You're not doing them or yourself any favors.
Right.
And I think that you should. I wish I'd even more like 100% been like, okay, you know,
just
like I'll try it.
Yeah.
Sometimes I was kind of like I don't know, or I don't, and it was more like, I didn't know if I could do it. It wasn't necessarily like I didn't trust their ideas. It was like, I don't know if, I think it was more like, I don't know if that's, you know, I think maybe I almost pigeonholed myself in a way. I'm like, I have something that I do, and I don't know if I can do that.
Right.
And a lot of it was probably stuff that, I think, because I started acting really young. I grew up in the city here, and I started acting as a teenager.
What was your first play?
My first real job actually was understudying in Brighton Beach Memoirs, a Neil Simon play on Broadway.
Yeah.
And it was Matthew Broderick had done it originally, and then Fisher Stevens took over for him. I don't know if you know him, but I was 14.
God.
Yeah, I was 14. And so that was my first experience. And I knew nothing. I was such, even though, because my parents were actors and I grew up around it, and I was still incredibly dim about a lot of stuff. I remember one of my first nights being at the theater, actually, and watching the show. I had to watch the show a million times and be there every night. And I remember seeing Rod Stewart in the audience.
Oh.
And I was like, wow, it's Rod Stewart. And then in the intermission, I kind of was watching him, and I followed, and he and his girlfriend walked out. They left the theater. I remember I came backstage before the second act started, and I was like, God, Rod Stewart is here. And they're like, oh, cool, wow, what do you think? And I'm like, oh, I don't know, he left, but he was with this woman. And they all went, they were like, oh, and they went back, and the stage manager was like, Josh, don't tell the actors that someone walked out. God. And I was like, oh, right. Like, I always felt like I was putting my foot in my mouth.
Are you one of those actors who does not want to know who's in the audience?
No, I actually like to know.
Oh, you do?
I've always liked to know. And I sort of feel like it focuses me in it sometimes in a way that I could be totally wrong. I'm not a good judge of, some actors like know when they've given a good performance or a bad performance,
yeah.
And they know the audience likes it or not. And
but
I'm
they
usually,
don't usually
I'm,
know.
Yeah,
know
I don't, I think
where...
people are misguided. I think they think they know.
Yeah.
And I know that I don't know.
That's very
I mean, I know, to the extent where like, if I think it was a good show, if I think like, yeah, I was really in it, I got all those laughs, and people were like, that was a good job, congratulations, you know. And the nights where I think like, oh God, I'm so embarrassed, I'm mortified, those are the nights usually where people think like, wow, that was amazing.
Yeah.
And it's often, I think it comes down to the simple thing of I think when you're watching yourself to the extent that you can sort of think like, ah, I'm really in it tonight, that means you're not vulnerable and you're not open enough to actually be vulnerable on stage. You're sort of, you know, you're at a remove and you're watching yourself. And, you know, the truth is, I think to be truly really vulnerable, it doesn't feel good. It's painful. It's uncomfortable, you know? So it's like, it's not, I think when you're really open and feel that way, you come off, it's like, you don't feel like, yeah, you're thinking, you're like, oh, you know, it feels bad. It feels weird.
Right.
And I think that's sometimes what people respond to,
right.
You know?
Right. Was there a moment that when you were a 14-year-old kid or 13 when you said, I want to be an actor or this is it? Or
yeah, it's funny because I think obviously a lot of actors know, or people say like, I knew when I was 3 or 4 and I didn't have that. Even having, and maybe it's because I had parents in the business, but I didn't, you know, it's not like I grew up far away from it. I was like, I want to do that.
Mm-hmm.
It was almost more, it's like, oh, that's what people do. I mean, I grew up around, you know, I'd hang out backstage. My mom didn't work that much as an actress, but my dad was a working actor. And so I was, you know, I would hang out backstage, and actors were so nice to kids, and I, you know, it was a very like, I didn't have to do that thing of like, I don't want to go into the family business, I want to be an actor. It was understandable, yeah. But I didn't have that thing, and even as a teenager, and in some ways, my mom sort of directed me towards it because I was growing up and I was starting to get in trouble and I was cutting school a lot and I was, you know, hanging out, and I think she was worried that I was gonna, you know,
be a drug addict.
Basically, yeah. I mean, yeah. And so she found out about this children's theater company in the city that was called the First All Children's Theater. And it was this very kind of intense, like serious thing. Every day after school from 4 to 7. And if you were late more than twice, you got kicked out.
Mm-hmm.
And it was fully intensive and immersive. And so while a lot of my friends were just like hanging out and getting in trouble, I started doing this thing after school when I was about 11 or 12. And it did give me a focus. And it was a good focus. And then when I was about 12 or 13, I started, my mom had a friend who knew someone who was starting a management company for kids who sang. And I sang before my voice changed, and I started doing jingles.
Do you remember any of the jingles?
Yeah.
What
it was like, crispy, chewy, crispy, chewy, brand new Duncan Hines for crispy, chewy. And, yeah, and so that's how I started doing it. And so all of a sudden I was like going to auditions after school. That became my, and up until then, like I'd been into sports, you know, and stuff. And then I started just doing that, and that became like my hobby. But it always felt like that. It felt like a hobby. Like some kids had sports or they played, you know, took music lessons. And I just, that's sort of what I did. But I did not know that I wanted to do it when I grew up. The truth is I felt conflicted about it. Through my 20s, I felt really conflicted about whether I even wanted to be doing it and whether it was something that
But you work pretty regularly right off the bat.
I worked enough that but I did. I did it through high school, but I wasn't like full time. I wasn't like a full time professional kid who was like, I didn't go to professional children's school or anything. I went to a regular high school, and my mom, her big thing was I always had to be doing okay in school in order to work. And I wasn't a good student. So sometimes I remember I had to drop out of a play once because I was failing in school.
What did you fail in? What subjects?
Oh, everything. Well, I went, and that was hard because I went to a school in Brooklyn called St. Anne's. It didn't have grades, and I was still failing.
That's a big school. Everybody's trying to get in there.
Yeah. My son goes there now, and I think I pulled the legacy. Yeah. But yeah, I remember it was very. So I liked it, but it was it really it felt more like a, like an after school activity or something that I was. It felt like something that I could, you know, that I could do, and it was, you know, it meant that girls would talk to you more though than they would have probably if I hadn't been. And so I liked that part of it.
Do you like working with kids? Now, what's the
I saw. Do I like working with kids as actors?
Yes.
Now?
Yes. Oh, that, I think that.
Yeah. I mean, yes and no. I mean, it depends on the kid. The part I don't like is the parents, because I think ultimately it makes me very uncomfortable, usually, truthfully, to be working with kids, because they usually come with this, with a parent, and that's a weird dynamic, you know, and the ultimately, I think I feel pretty strongly that kids should be kids and should just be living their lives and shouldn't be in that position of trying to do it good and you know, and
did
maybe
you ever
that,
have a scene in a movie, for instance, where you took the kid aside, you were playing the father, I'm trying to think of the movie right now, and you gave the kid direction, you helped?
I did a TV series this year that hasn't all aired yet.
Grace Point?
Yeah, but there was a kid in it, and I would... Oh, that you're talking about?
I think that's
Yeah, so I would... sometimes I would, yeah, but that's tricky too, because you don't want to step on a director's toes.
Right.
But there was one time when we were, like, the director was far away, and we were, like, in this really intense scene with this kid, and he had to be, like, crying, and the director was sort of, like, trying to yell direction at him, and the kid was, like, obviously just, like, it was all his close-up, and he was starting to, like, get really tense, and I sort of, like, I was starting to whisper direction to him, and I was like, sorry, is that okay? And he was like, God, no, the director afterwards was like, thank you for, but, you know, you don't always, not every director is going to want you to be directing their actors.
So here's a quote of yours. You do TV and movies to...
Oh, God, no.
Okay, I won't. Forget it.
No, I just have a personal pet peeve about this quote, because it's like some, it was from some, like,
no,
backstage.
It's wonderful. You said I would pay to do theater.
Yeah.
And it's not right.
Well, okay, yeah, sorry, read the quote. I'll tell you why.
English accent?
No, it's not that. It's just, it was some, like, Backstage magazine. I don't think it even exists.
Oh,
it was like some, like, little pamphlet,
some
like 50, 20
movie.
Years ago. I did, like, a theater. Okay. It was like an off Broadway magazine.
Shall I whisper it to you, and then do you want to read it first?
No, it just says, like, you do TV
and
films for
money. And then
money,
you do theater for the love of it. I think at this point in my life, I would pay to do theater if that's how it worked.
Yeah. The thing is, it was a quote that was taken out of context, like all quotes. Why I don't like it is because IMDb, they can put up whatever they want, and someone, and that quote is the only quote of mine that's ever been on IMDb. Which, if you were like looking to, you know, if you're a director for film or TV, you'd be like, "Fuck you."
You know?
And so I've actually written them, and I don't know how do you write, like, dear IMDb? I'm like, they won't take it down. I have no control over it. And it's just some random quote that they pulled, and I can't get rid of it.
So, but do you,
what I meant, of course, the irony about that is, of course, you do pay to do theater always, because you never, you know, you rarely make enough money to, like, actually, so you're always sort of paid in one way or another.
Right.
And that's not how I feel at all. I think I was talking to a theater magazine, and so I was just,
right.
It was out of context,
right.
You know.
Okay.
You can have good and bad experiences in any medium. It depends on the writing and who you're working with. Ultimately, the writing and who you're working with. That's what it comes down to, and the role.
Right.
I personally like theater because I'm slow, and I like the rehearsal process that you get to figure stuff out. And it takes me a long time to figure stuff out. And I've always felt with film and TV that you sort of, you know, all of a sudden you do it, and then, you know, that night or months later you wake up and you're like, oh, God, no, I know how... You know, and it's taken me years and years and years to try to, like, loosen up and not think about and try to be like, well, it is what it is, and not try to, like, I was always like, God, it's going to be on film forever.
Right, right.
And so I always felt like I was just, like, so tight and clenched, like, trying to, like, give a good performance. And it was, you know, instead of being loose and just think of it as, like, rehearsal or something, and they'll cut it together. But that's why I've always liked theater more, is because you get the time. It's like the groundhog thing, like, every night getting a chance to, like,
right.
You know, like, I love long runs. A lot of actors hate long runs. They get bored. But I've always, you know, it takes. I'll be doing a play for, like, months into it, and all of a sudden I'll think, like, that's what I mean in that line. Or, you know, I'm amazed at how pennies drops, like, endlessly. You know,
in the DVD which I'm going to give you, Uta Hagen says when she was doing The Cherry Orchard, she did a number of productions of The Cherry Orchard.
Yeah, I've done two.
And she said it wasn't until the last night that she finally knew how to say goodbye to the cherry orchard.
Exactly. And Chekhov, I think, more than anything. I think that's why actors love to do Chekhov, but it's also, and, like, I don't think anyone, it's impossible. Like, I only did new plays for most of my career, and I didn't go to drama school. And I think that's one of the reasons why I always felt like, oh, classical works are something that like real actors did, or people who like went to drama school were trained to like do these things did. And I always, you get pigeonholed too. I think whatever you do, people think, oh, that's what they do. You know, yeah. So I just was never hired to do anything that wasn't, but it wasn't until about 7 years ago that I did a play where the playwright wasn't in the room. You know, I'd always had the playwrights and I've always done new plays. And then about 7 years ago, I got hired to do a, like a little part in a Chekhov and a Shakespeare. And I was like, okay, it's time.
What did you do?
It was called the Bridge Project. It was this thing that Sam Mendes directed, and it was half British actors and half American actors. And we did it. We did The Cherry Orchard and The Winter's Tale, and we started at BAM, and then we went around the world, and then we ended up at the Old Vic in London.
Wow.
And it was a trial by fire in that, like, not only was I doing Chekhov and Shakespeare for the first time, but I was doing it with, like, some of the best British Shakespearean and Chekhovian actors in the world. I mean, I've never been so humiliated and mortified on a daily basis. Like, in the Shakespeare, first of all, just because I was like, but the Chekhov was what I spent all my life seeing all these Chekhov productions and always going like, why isn't this better? Like, why?
Yeah.
There's always like one or two people.
Yeah.
Have you had the experience? You know what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
You're always like, God, this is, there's like always a couple of people. They're like, well, they're great. But, and you think like, wow, I never realized this play is all about fears. It's all about the old man. And you see another production, you're like, God, this play is all about her. And it's like, you realize why actors love to do Chekhov and why they so rarely work as cohesive productions is because it's almost impossible. I remember running into a friend of mine who was in rehearsal and I was so distraught. And I was like, I feel like I'm just terrible. And he goes, Chekhov is like, it's like trying to hold water in your hand. It's like every time you think you have a moment figured out, then like the next night, it's like, it's gone. It's so, and like one moment here happens here. And then that affects the next three scenes. And it's so fragile.
Yeah.
And I think why actors love doing it is because you never feel like you figured it out. I don't think actors ever finish a night of doing a Chekhov play and think like, nailed it. You know, they're like, ha ha.
Yeah.
I think it's like a million, every moment, it's like a million different puzzles. And you can do it a million different ways. And every night it's like, oh, I'm going to try this.
What are you doing now? What did I do?
I played Yasha, the sort of the uppity servant in the cherry orchard who thinks he's, you know, who wants to be, you know, above everyone else.
Natasha's in love with him.
Dunyasha's in love with him.
He wants to marry up.
Yeah, exactly.
Right.
Yeah. You know, and it was, and then a couple years later, I did a production of The Cherry Orchard where I played Treplev, right? No, Constantine.
No, that's the seagull.
Yeah, I get them all mixed up. You know, who's
the Cherry Orchard?
No, not Trigorin. I want to play Trigorin.
Oh,
but
you
no.
played the landowner?
No. I played the student.
Yeah.
The eternal student.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Treplev, right?
No. No, that's the seagull.
Yeah. Trofimov, yes. Trofimov, yes.
Yeah, we knew it was a T.
Yeah. With John Turturro playing the Londoner and Diane Wiest playing Ravenskaya. No, that's...
Was that at the new group?
At the CSC.
I saw it.
Oh, yeah.
You were great.
You have to say that now. But, and again,
Oh, that was amazing.
But I realized why actors want to do them over and over again, because you never feel like you get it right.
Right.
You know, and you learn, and every production is so different based on the chemistry of the people in it. But to try to get dispersed casts all in the same world, in a cohesive production in 3.5 weeks is like next to impossible.
It,
and that's why you see these productions that are always like, oh, wow, why isn't it better?
I do remember it now, because I remember you and Diane had a seduction scene.
Yeah, well, it's a scene where
she was coming after you.
Yeah.
I remember that. And I remember when Diane entered, she was so full of sorrow away for that lost child.
Yes.
It was the first time I'd ever seen that.
Oh,
so
I loved working with her so much. It was like acting with water. She's like water.
Oh, yes.
Where you're,
yes.
And she and I would change the blocking every night.
Great.
And we would just, and you have to really trust someone to be able to do that. No, I did a Three Sisters at CSC that Austin directed. Austin Pendleton.
Right.
Who's a fantastic, and he's a fantastic Chekhovian director.
Yes.
Because he came up through the Williamstown with, Nikos Sakharopoulos, Nikos Sakharopoulos is the guy who ran Williamstown Theater Company, who was like, you know, Americans can do Chekhov, and we don't need to do it like the British, we can do it like Americans, and he's like, just full of life, and Austin's from that school, or he's like, just, like, don't try to, you know, because the British are like the people who are like most constitutionally unsuited to do Chekhov out of like everyone, you know, and those are so many productions we see, and they're all kind of like, you know, like, you know.
I'm in mourning for my life.
Yes, they're all, you know. And Americans are much closer to Russians in that sort of like, you know, like, ah, you know.
Yeah, passion.
Yeah, so yeah.
And funny, you never see Chuck,
funny,
but it's
yeah.
really funny, and it is funny.
Yeah.
Because it's so sad, but it's like life.
Yeah.
You know, that moment where Masha says, you've aged, she says to you.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah,
and
yeah.
It says crying through her tears, yeah. which is a hard thing for any actor to think, I have to do that. But it's funny because we look at each, well, I won't go on.
No, but that's the Russian thing of turning on a dime, you know, crying and then laughing. And...
So complete this sentence, Josh Hamilton. Here's what I want in a director.
A good director has to know when to give a note,
yes.
when to let you find it on your own, when to say something encouraging, and when to say, oh, you want, actually, that's not good. You can do it better. It's like, you know, like the wrong note at the wrong time can be very, you can lose a lot of time kind of going down a wrong alley. It's, so I don't know. I don't know what I want in a director or what I respond to most. I mean, I do personally do like a lot of directions. I mean, honestly, it's embarrassing, but I almost like line reading sometimes, because sometimes,
really?
Not like say it like this, but like this is sometimes directors, like, I think directors want to give line readings, but they know they're not supposed to. So they sort of go around this, like, yes. they sort of say like, they kind of, they'll sort of go out of their way to kind of try to tell you what they want. And sometimes it's just like, it kind of, I've like, just cut to the chase. Like, just tell me like, like, oh, okay. Like that, like louder or, you know.
Yeah. Hit that word.
Yeah, yeah, because sometimes it is that technical. You know, it can be. Yeah. I don't need to be like Pat. I don't need to be coddled or like you know, like some actors like
Elia Kazan, who gets to know your personal life and then comes over to you and says.
Oh, I don't mind that. Actually, I would. Yeah, I do feel like whatever gets the great performance. I mean, I think it's fine when directors manipulate people, especially for film, where it's only, you know, it's just going to be like right. one take, because you know, all you need is that one good take, and right. so.
Do you like to do a lot of takes or?
Yes, I'm a total take whore.
Well,
oh God, yes, the more the better, absolutely.
I never heard that expression. That's
oh
great.
Yeah. No, I get better. Like some actors, it's so different. Some actors like peak on their first or their second. You know, different. Every actor has their own thing, and if you ask directors, as a shoot goes on, they get to know which actors. Peak early and which ones get better, and sometimes like they'll
makes
know
sense.
They'll sometimes they'll know like, oh, I have to do their coverage first because they're, you know, they're really good, like they start off great and then they get worse and worse.
Yes.
And other actors, it's like, oh, they, you know, they start off, it takes a while for them to find it until they get really comfortable.
Yes.
And they're all different, so directors I think have to get good at knowing like which actors are going to be, how, you know, how they work. And I get, the more I do it, the more comfortable I get, and the more I can sort of, you know. One thing I love for directors to do, especially on film, is to be like, okay, you know what? We have it.
Right.
I'm totally happy we have it. Now just do one for yourself.
Mm-hmm.
That's always, and I'm always surprised more directors don't do that
right.
On film and TV, because that I think is instantly, you see actors like, they're like, oh, great, you got it? And now I can just like do what I want, and all of a sudden they feel free to like be truly creative, or in, you know, what they really want to do. They're not trying to please the director, and that's often the ones like I think like turn out the best.
If you have a very, very emotional scene, can you get it going again and again? Or
yeah, I'd rather have more chances, because if I think I only have one. Here's the thing about film. I was talking about before about always. I think ultimately it's about relaxation. I mean, most important thing is relaxation. And I used to feel like when I used to have emotional scenes for like an hour or two before.
I was just going to ask you that.
Because also you just don't know how to time it with films. So often it's like,
yes.
you think like, you know, you don't know how to like pace yourself, and you have to kind of, if you have emotional stuff, you can't
right.
stay in that.
No.
And so I used to like listen to music and be like, you know, for like hours before, be like, you know, and then the time they get there, it's like, you're just like, you've worked yourself into this thing, and you're like, you're so tight, and you're, you know, and I think ultimately now I try to be relaxed and whatever that does. And it's like, but you also don't want to like fritter away. Like, it means different things to different people. You know, it's like some people need to talk and be around other people and just joke around, and then they're relaxed and then they can kind of go into it. And other people just need to kind of be quiet. And but I think ultimately it's whatever keeps you relaxed. Cause I think you can't, if you try to work yourself up into a lather on film and TV, it's like you're so often just, you're just tight, and you're not going to be in the moment when it comes to be on camera. Yeah.
You know, the first moment in The Real Thing, you have to start the play off every night, right?
Yeah.
What kind of preparation that is. Because you hit it pretty hard right away.
Yeah, it's different night to night.
Some
nights,
is it?
Yeah. The other thing, for better or worse, about 7 years ago, is when I was doing that bridge project thing, and I was really confused and depressed about what we were doing. And I found this book by this, he's actually an American director, but he worked in England mostly. It was called Different Every Night by this guy named Mike Alfreds. Do you know this guy? You know this book? His whole theory was, I think for most of the time when I was working, I'd always try to try to figure out your performance, and then you sort of stay, you kind of freeze it, and then, it develops during the run. And actually, I'd always, as a run went on, I would always like to kind of think of new stuff, but I always felt like you had to stay pretty close to what you did. And then I read this book. It was like, be different every night, know what your intentions are, but know what your objective is, but you can use different intentions to get there every night and keep it fresh. And why should an audience pay to come see some flash frozen thing that was set, months ago, and things are, theater is an organic living nightly experience. It should be a happening. And I read this, and Ethan Hawke was in the show too, and we were sharing the dressing room.
Is this Hurley Burley?
No, this was the Bridge Project.
Oh, okay.
We were both of us were like, I don't know what we're doing. So we were grasping at straws, and we're like, hey, let's do this. And so we started just going out and and we'd just yell our lines one night, and the British actor's like, what are you doing?
But it listened.
And I think it might have affected me a little too much, because I find myself sort of every night being like, I'm gonna try it like this.
Yeah.
And it's probably not as different as I think it is. Mm-hmm. It's probably...
Well, I just loved that opening, because what I got from you was a man who was trying to, he has to nail his wife for being unfaithful, but he can't just out and out ask her if she's been unfaithful. But you have to kind of steer her into... It's a real
Stockard in particular, I find incredibly challenging, especially for American actors. And also, this goes back to the training thing, because I didn't go to drama school.
You didn't, so how do you know?
How do I know it?
Well, words like intention.
I'm obsessed with acting books.
Really?
Yeah. I did take an acting class. I studied with Bill Esper for a year.
Oh, sure.
When I was maybe 20. Okay. I went to college. I was working in high school semi-professionally. I do one or two things a year, maybe an off-Broadway show or an after-school special. And then I still wasn't sure I wanted to be an actor, so I went to college for 2 years.
Where'd you go?
I went to Brown, I didn't take acting there. I went and took other classes to sort of see if I wanted to be anything else, because I really didn't know if I wanted to be an actor. And part of it, I think a lot of it was tied up with my parents. It's like my father was an actor, and did I want to, he struggled a lot, and also I think I was maybe nervous about surpassing him too. It's that funny thing. It's like it was a guilt, and it was I was very conflicted about it.
Sure.
And I think that kept me anyway. So I didn't go to drama school, and I always felt because what I was mostly asked to do was to kind of be myself and be natural and thing. And for years, I think it was very limiting and pigeonholed, because I'd read scripts and I'd be like, oh, I can't play that. I'm not like that. This character is completely different from me. Mm-hmm. Instead of going ooh, I want to play that character and create that character because he's so unlike me. Instead of getting excited about that, I was like, no, that's not in my wheelhouse. I frustrated my agents endlessly, because I was like, oh no, that's, I'm not like him, so I can't play him, which is ridiculous. It's like the whole point. It's to be able to not be yourself. That's what's gonna be so freeing about it.
Right.
But it literally took me decades to figure that out.
Right.
And to play. And also all the stuff I was asked to do was incredibly naturalistic, real, just kitchen sink stuff. And it wasn't until I think maybe I was in my, late 30s that I did a, or mid-30s that I did a production that was, it was an adaptation of the Cider House Rules, the novel, and it was almost storybook theater, where we sort of said what we acted out, and there was no, it was not mine, it was kind of, well, some of it was mine, but it was acting out stuff, and it was incredibly freeing. I'd never done, and I was like, oh my God, this is so fun, and I rediscovered, I was like, oh, it's like play. It was the first time in years that I felt
physically.
I felt released from the thing of having to be real, realistic and naturalistic, which I think, as I've gotten older, I've become fascinated with the concept of style, and every playwright and every show has its own style, and that's the fun and the joy is figuring out what style is this playwright, and what style is this production, and I love, the productions that I love seeing now are so often Ivo Van Hove stuff, or deconstructed stuff, where it's not the opposite of there's no onus on being real, you know.
Did you see his production of Hedda Gabler?
Yeah.
Wasn't that astonishing?
Yeah.
When she took
yeah.
those flowers and...
Yeah, and it's like, I don't ever want to see like another Hedda Gabler in my life. It's
I
like,
know, me too.
You know, like always like regular productions.
Right.
And that, I was like, oh, great. You
yeah,
know?
He just opened it up.
Yeah.
Oh, boy.
So Stoppard in particular, when you asked
yes.
about the Stoppard, it's like you know, Stoppard says, this is the third time that I've worked with him. I did his play, Coast of Utopia,
yes.
which was like a 9-hour thing. And that was the first time I'd done it. And that was also one of the first times that I'd done things that required the kind of technical stuff that you learn in drama school, you know, how to speak and how to hit your consonants. And I just never done that. And I realized it's really important for a lot of stuff, you know, and I was always kind of like, oh, I don't, you know,
right.
I don't, you know.
I can be Al Pacino.
Yeah, I can just feel it, you know. And I remember being in rehearsals with him, and the director, I think, didn't really know how to... I have a feeling Tom Stoppard asked to take over the direction of the scene that I was in, because I was in a scene with Jennifer Ely, and she'd done a bunch of Tom Stoppard, and she's British and very trained, and
right.
and she... And Tom, we did the scene, and Tom said, Chelsea, you're being very real. You're speaking as if we're just talking in the green room, and it's very believable and very real and very natural. Look at what Jennifer's doing. She's super real. And that's what I want. I want you to be super real. This is how he has a kind of a lisp. And I was like, and I remember at the time thinking like, it's like, I was acting with her. I was like, she was not even looking at me, man. I was like, she's not connecting. She was kind of like saying all her words out to the audience and speaking in a very kind of like, you know. And I was like, I can't act with her. She's not... And I remember, and I'm so embarrassed now because I realize, of course, it's like he was so right, and he knows how his plays work,
right.
Like how it's, the audience doesn't care in his plays. It's not naturalism. It's not like
it's
people
heightened.
Talking like this. It's totally heightened,
right.
And it is. And he, and when people ask him what he looks for in an actor, he says clarity of utterance.
Yes,
it is the most important thing to him because if people can't understand every single word,
right.
And after run throughs or after shows, he'd say like, I remember he came up to one actor and he said, Jason, are you using consonants? Because I can't understand a single word you're saying. You know, he's devastating notes. But the thing is, he's right, because if people, his stuff is so intellectually intimidating anyway, and if you don't follow it, if you don't, and I remember once he came up to me and he said, I couldn't hear this line, and I said, really, God, I feel like I'm yelling it, and he goes, well, it's not that I couldn't hear it, it's that I'm not being told to listen.
Oh, wasn't that good?
And I thought that was such a
That's
interesting
a great
note, because it's like, yeah, he's like, I could hear you, but it's like, it's not his stuff, it's like, audiences are just trying to figure out, like, what people are saying, what's
right,
happening,
right.
And ideally, they want to believe that people are actually talking and listening to each other in a fairly human way. But most importantly, they need to hear every thought and the intention and the clarity of the thought. And that is achieved by clarity, intention of, you know, of the words. And that's something that in American training is not necessarily usually emphasized.
No, I mean, Uda talks about, and you'll see, verbal intention.
Yeah.
Which is very, very hard and harder and harder.
We all drop
teach
it. I've always been told, all my life, I've been told that I drop the ends of my sentences. And it was so frustrating because literally I was like, what do you mean? Like, I didn't even understand, like, I was like, wow. Like, you kind of just go down. And that's a very modern, contemporary way of speaking.
Mm-hmm.
Especially when I was doing Shakespeare, they're like, don't go down on the end of your sentences. I'm like, okay. And I just didn't even hear. I didn't even have an ear for what they were talking about.
Right.
And I'm just beginning now, I think, to sort of like, to understand that like, it is to just follow through. And it was, you know, there's a teacher named Patsy Rodenberg. Do you know,
yeah,
have you heard of her? Do you
yeah.
know, you guys work with her? She is incredible. Right before I did the Bridge Project, I did like a 6-day crash course with her of Shakespeare.
Wow.
And it was the first time in my life where she made me single-handedly fall in love with Shakespeare and be like, oh, I see why people love doing it. Like, and all about, but I mean, I wasn't enough to, I didn't learn it. It's like, I mean, I learned that it was why I wanted to do more of it, but I didn't, it's not like I learned how to do it. And I'm still like,
it's endless.
And but that is something. I mean, do you guys study stuff like that?
Yeah.
So it's really not until I've gotten older that I really regret not having gone to drama school.
Well, it's not too late.
No, it's not too late. It's not too late. And I do. I mean, I still do. I read tons of books and I do take individual classes. And now, lots of times I work, you know, like on this show and on the Coast Utopia, they had, you work with speech, you know, accent people or speech people, and so you do a lot of exercises.
I was going to ask you about that because you have a great British accent. I really wouldn't know.
Are you messing with me?
I'm not messing with you. I'm not really.
It was a huge. I'd never done an accent before. I've always thought I was just terrible at accents, and I was mortified. And one of the reasons why I wanted to do this was as a challenge. Was like I'm 45, and I was like, I've never done an accent before.
It's sort of a mark of maturity in the American actor.
Yeah.
To do a British accent.
But it is because in that way, like I didn't when I was younger, I didn't take roles that stretched myself. I stayed really within things that I could, so, you know, and I was often cast as like a writer's, you know, a contemporary writer's alter ego, you know, which I was so happy to be able to do. But those often aren't the most interesting parts, because usually the parts in the center of the play where that things are happening too, you know, and it was the other characters around. So you get to sort of react to things, but a lot of the most interesting characters are the people that are affecting you, you know, that are sort of, yeah. And those are, as I've gotten older, I find those are often the roles that actually are more fun to play, instead of being the kind of person who's like bouncing around like a ping pong ball in the middle of the play for all these people and kind of just being like, you know, because usually, you know, those are the roles that writers, when they're writing themselves, it's like they're the people that things are happening to usually.
Yes, yes.
And so you're sort of just, you know, done a lot of reactionary roles as opposed to, you know, forward.
But you know how to listen. That's one of the hardest things, don't you think? Especially when the camera is on you and you're listening to the other person.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, in some ways I'm probably more comfortable listening than not.
I mean, when you're listening, do you apply any particular technique? I mean, in other words, well, I mean, are you listening for something?
I don't know. I mean, I'm still trying to figure. I mean, I'll be honest. It's like I am not like when she first asked me to do this, I was like, I can't talk to actors. I don't know what I'm doing.
I
was like, I am like the last person. You know, some actors love to like teach or direct or something. Like, I'm not.
I was going
to
ask you that.
Every job, every time I think I figure something out, or I think like I know how to do it, it's almost always that the role is well written. And when things, when I feel like I'm not good in things, or I'm struggling to make things work, it's almost always because the role doesn't quite work, or the writing's not, you know. And I don't every job feels different. Every time you think like, oh yeah, I could do this acting thing, like, maybe I have a handle on this, and then you go into the next thing, and it's a different style, and or a different role. It asks different things of you, and you're like, it's square one. Every job feels like you're starting for me. Feels like you're starting from square one again.
Wonderful.
And so when I say like I'm obsessed with, I keep tons of acting books backstage and on set with me, because I'm always looking through things. I'm always looking to be re-inspired and be like, and just because of certain basics that I think and a lot of it is like some sort of desperate attempt at like trying to like, you know, like I'm prepared, yeah. But you know, but I mean, I'll just before the show, I'll be like, oh right, like, oh, we're like, remember to actually, you know, really want something or to do something to the other person. It's like the basic stuff. You're like, but you just forget, you know, even during a long run, or you're like, oh, right, actually, like, don't worry about getting the laughs. Just try to do something to the other person. You can try to get something from them or try to affect them in some way. And not even the other person, not like, not some like abstract of the person, like literally the other person, the other actor. Like, use personal stuff. Like, use, like, if you know, like, if you feel a certain way about an actor, if you know something about the actual person, be like, you know,
do it.
It's like, you know, do it. Right. Like, mean it, you know, be like.
Let me ask you, when you come to the first rehearsal, let's say, of The Real Thing, first rehearsal, what do you already know? What have you already worked on?
Well, and that's another thing about first starting, is that a lot of actors don't like to be off book before rehearsals. They like to sort of figure it out with the blocking organically, and they don't want to. And that's how I was for years and for most of my career. And then I always felt like I was spending most of rehearsal trying to learn the lines and trying to, like, you know, be like, And I realized at a certain point that I couldn't fully lose myself or really concentrate on what I wanted or what I was trying to do to the other people until the words were second nature. And that's one of the reasons why I like long runs, because it wasn't until you run it for a while that the words become completely second nature. You're not trying to think like, what's that line? And so I try to come in off book now at the top. Yeah, I try to come in off book. The first time I did that was with Hurley Burley.
Oh my God!
Because that writing
language.
Was so it's so on the surface it seems so naturalistic. I don't know if you guys know David Rabe's writing. Or
do you know Hurley Burley?
Hurley Burley. You know,
yeah.
It's Hurley Burley. It's a fantastic play, but it's all like it's like fucking this. Fuck. It's like it sounds like you. It sounds like you could say it any which way.
Yeah.
It's that kind of naturalistic, almost like Mammoth in that way. But yeah. it's incredibly
it's florid.
Florid is the perfect word for it. It's floridly naturalistic writing.
Yes.
And incredible. And I remember.
And rhythmic.
And rhythmic. And I remember coming in. So I came in off book, and it was the first time in a rehearsal process that I was able to completely think about my character and what I was doing and not the lines. And it was so freeing.
Yes.
And I also realized that, because a lot of the other actors would just try to like kind of learn it in rehearsal, in rehearsals. And then I remember we were running for a few weeks, and I was backstage listening to a scene off stage that I wasn't in, and I was following along with the script for some reason. I realized that like 3 pages went by and not one actor said the line the way it was actually written. And
was David Rabe there? I hope not.
I mean, but he'd been seeing it like that, yeah. And it was like, it must have killed him, you know?
Oh, God.
I think I was a little laissez-faire when I was younger, especially with things that were new plays or naturalistic, because often, you know, they're doing a lot of rewriting and changing things in rehearsals and in previews, and so it feels like maybe the language is a little bit more fluid or, you know, like up for grabs. But obviously, every writer has an incredibly strong reason for every word that's there.
Right.
And I think I often would, not on purpose, but just because I would be a little loose sometimes, you know, and I wish that I had been more conscious of being word perfect.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Auditioning, you like it? You hate it? Are you good at it?
Something is I wish that I'd known when I was younger was to audition better when I was younger. I think for years I was in I was incredibly naive and thought that directors would be able to sort of know that on the day I could do it, and that auditions were just sort of like a preliminary, like it's like not something like, and I would not
work on it.
I would not work on it. I was very, like I say, I was very conflicted about a lot of things. Yeah. I wasn't focused when I was younger. Excuse me. I wanted to be good. It's not like I didn't care about it. I wanted to do well, but I didn't take the steps that would have me do. So I think I was sort of a lot of my 20s were like filled with like angst and like depression and like,
yeah, you were resistant.
And all my friends were starting to like become movie stars. A lot of my friends were starting to do movies.
Help.
And I was just like, so it was a long time of like, why aren't, but part of it, I think really was I didn't audition well. I would come in and I'd be like, you know, we could just kind of read through this quickly. And then, but you know, like, I mean, I thought they'd hire me because they knew I could do a good job in the day, but they don't know, you know, they have no idea. And that's why so often people who audition well are get the jobs over people who, I'm not saying that I should have gotten them. I'm just meaning that like some people have a really good auditioning skill. They know how to sell themselves well, and they can walk into a room and they're like, hey, you know.
Yeah, but we always can spot that.
Yes.
It's people who are marketeers rather than who really want to do the part.
Yes, but on the other hand, everyone's nervous. The casting people are nervous. Oh, yeah. The studios are nervous. The directors are nervous. Oh. And they want to know that the person...
Weren't you in on some auditions? Was it Jonathan? Because you said something about I learned so much about...
Oh, I've been on lots of times. I think because I was the writer's alter ego, lots of times I was cast first and then I would read with people.
Yes.
And so I've been on the other side of lots of auditions. And it's amazing because you'd see the things people do, like the little nervousness or things that people... And I'd make notes myself like, oh, what not to do, what to do.
Yeah.
And then, of course, they all go out the window next time you go into an audition. It's like I was always just so nervous, and I would kind of just shut down. And
what's the biggest thing you learned being on the other side, reading with somebody in the auditioning process? What do you really need to have aside from knowing what the part's about and why you love it and why you can personalize it?
Yeah. I mean, that's the thing, is that usually you don't necessarily have enough time to prepare an audition to do an in-depth thing. And sometimes when I would work on it too much, I would do the same thing with films. Like I'd become too tight, and I would sort of. It's always trying to find the right balance of caring and not caring, and it happens for auditions and working. It's always finding that right balance of like caring enough to be focused and do your best, but not caring so much that you're not relaxed enough to do your best. And I think that especially happens for auditions because you're inherently so nervous and tense. And I think you try to give them a sense of who you are as a person. You know, it's hard to go in and give like a full-blown characterization of something if it's not you, because it's like, you know, you've had maybe a day or two or a couple of days to get ready for it, or, you know, if that. And, you know, I would try to be, you know, you try to be as comfortable with it. Oftentimes, though, sometimes I'd try to get off book with auditions, and then instead of actually just being comfortable in the moment, I'd be trying to remember the lines.
Right.
You know, so it's not a memory contest. It's right. They just want to see if, you know, you're right
and
for
I think
the part.
Is it, and
the biggest thing I learned, actually, is that so often it has so little to do with how good an audition they give. It so often just has to do with
chemical.
Their chemistry, of, like, especially if someone's already cast, how they're going to look next to the person. I mean, it's just like, not just like how they look, whether they're attractive or not. It's just, it's how they, it's who their essence, how their basic essence fits together in the scheme of how they see that character and who else, and the other characters.
Right. And do you know, I believe that these two would be together?
Yeah. And do I believe those two would be together?
Yeah.
And so actually, it actually made me feel better because some people came in and great, because whenever I'd go in and give an audition and not get it, you think, automatically think, I suck.
Yeah.
They hated me, I gave a terrible audition, that's why I didn't get it.
Right.
And it's so not the case.
Right.
It was usually because for all those other reasons that have not, that you literally can't do anything about.
Right.
And so I tried to remember not to beat myself up when I didn't get a job, that it was not about something that was in your control.
Did you ever live in LA?
I've never lived there. I spent a lot of time out there working or for auditioning. And everyone, you know, in New York, you go to like an audition and people like, you know, look kind of like, they look like, you know, like people, like us, like we look. And you go out there and people do, and they just look different, you know, they're like, you know, and so for years I would like, get off the plane there. And I'd be like, oh my God, I got to go to the gym and I got to like, you know,
Gold's
have my
gym.
Teeth capped. And
yep, exactly.
And you go to like waiting rooms and everyone looks like, they look like
polished.
The most beautiful people you've ever seen. They're all, you know, and I would go in and I they don't understand self-deprecation in LA, I'd be like, oh my God. And you know, I'd be like, oh God, you know who you should get for this part? I just make jokes. And they'd be like,
it's awful.
Yeah. So I've been really lucky by being able to live here. The reason I've been able to stay here and subsidize my theater habit is voiceovers, actually, I'm like able to like have a family here and not, and haven't had to go like,
did you study
and not
having
to like go out and do pilot season in LA every year.
Did you take lessons how to do voiceovers?
No, trial and error. I auditioned for them for years before getting anything.
Yes.
And then
you started
getting them. Yeah.
And give me a voiceover thing that you've done that I might.
Well, right now I do MasterCard. I've done you know, for years I did Volvo. That just ended recently. The biggest actually training thing I did, one of the first jobs I got was doing all the promos for the History Channel for like 2 years. And that was the steadiest job I ever had. It was like 3 or 4 days a week for like a couple hours a day.
Wow.
And so that's where I learned about like timing and things. And it was all like, you know, like tonight on Ice Road Truckers, you know, kind of like, you know, like ridiculous.
No, it's great.
Yeah. But I'm so grateful that I actually like doing it. I have like this weird little OCD part of me that like I can like, because you work on plays or things and they're so amorphous and untanned. You're like, oh, God. And these, it's like 30 seconds I can get back and wrap my mind around, you know.
Right. Do you think directors should take acting lessons?
Yes, absolutely. Yeah.
Because?
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I'm not saying that necessarily all actors are, you can obviously be a great director without being an actor, but actors, I definitely like working with directors who are actors.
Do you prefer comedy as opposed to drama or no? You don't?
On stage, I certainly, I mean, there's nothing, yeah, I mean, I'm a laugh. Here's the biggest, you asked about things I wish I knew when I was younger. Okay,
yeah.
This is actually a huge thing, and I relearn it on a daily basis. That the only way, you know, actors love doing plays in terms of, as opposed to film and things, you get that immediate feedback, right? There laughs, a response, and that feels so good. I mean, I'm sure it's a lot of reasons why people, you're like, you get that laugh, and you're like, oh my God, that feels amazing. I want to do that. You know, I mean, how many jobs? Like people, you know, you get applauded at the end of your job. It's like, that's, you know, it's like people do real things and important things, and like, they don't get applauded at the end of the day, you know?
Right.
It's ridiculous.
Right.
And so as a young actor, you get a laugh and you think, all right, you know, like I nailed that. I got that laugh. And you think that that's like the be all and end all. And I remember I was doing Eric Bogosian's play called Suburbia at Lincoln Center in like 1994.
Yeah.
And I remember doing a show, a performance and getting a lot of laughs.
and like finding laughs. And I think a lot of it, like, you know, because once you learn how to sometimes get a laugh, it's like sometimes it's just a matter of being louder or like punching a thing, or, you know, there's certain sort of like sitcom rhythms that you can get into and people go like, ha ha ha, you know, it's like, and once you realize, and especially if you do a run, you're like, oh, if I raise my eyebrow when I say that line, I can get a laugh. And it's very seductive, you know? And I remember he came back afterwards and he said, it's not, getting laughs is not the most important thing. You think that it is, but it's not, because there's always going to be a couple yahoos out there who'll laugh at anything. And you can play to them and you think like, oh yeah, I'm doing great, you know? But a lot of people, it's like, they're not, that's not, you know, to be honest and really listen, it's like, that's what's more important. It's not to like get the laughs. And I remember thinking, like, I remember not believing him. I'd be like, okay.
Yeah.
Like, yeah, right. Yeah. But like, but then you need to get that laugh. And you're like, yes, got that laugh. I learned over and over again that that's not the most important thing. And a lot of it goes back to that thing about, because you do shows where you get a lot of laughs and you think like, all right, that was a good show. I'm going to get, especially if you have someone there and you think like, oh, they're going to, I'm so glad they were here for a good show. And they're like, hey, it was good. And then you do shows where you don't get a laugh and you think they hate it. Because that's the only way that audience actors can really gauge, like, whether, you know, because you're not, you can tell if they're listening, I guess. If they're coughing, you know, it's not a good sign, yeah, a lot. But otherwise, if like they're laughing, you think, like, that's, laughter is not a good barometer for whether necessarily the audience is, or whether it's a good show, or whether they're enjoying it. Yeah. And I learned that over and over. I never really learned that.
Did you ever get fired?
Yes. I was fired. I was actually fired from that Brighton Beach Memoirs understudying job, but more just because I was young and I never actually went on.
But you had understudy rehearsals and you weren't prepared?
Yeah, I think in general I was just a little too young. I wasn't focused enough for them. Yeah. I've never been fired from like a big. No, I don't think I've ever been fired from anything.
Did another actor ever give you a direction?
Yeah, sure, absolutely. I'm fine with that. I always want to know. Like, I don't need to be like patted on the back. Like, I want to know when something. And it's funny actually, because when we're doing the Bridge Project, British actors are much more comfortable. They all, they're fully comfortable discussing each other's performances and giving each other notes and rehearsals, and they'll be like, oh, you know that moment? I think if you come in actually, but later, if you come in, and then I'm like, oh, I did just, you know, you just get that laugh too. And I remember the first time. Simon Russell Beale said something to Ethan, and Ethan said, he said, I'm sorry. Who's playing this part? Like, because American actors are like the sort of unspoken taboo. Like, you do not direct each other, you know.
Right.
And but I actually think I'm fine with it. Like, I just want to. Like, I'm not precious about that. Like, sometimes you think you're doing something, or it's not, or it's a. I just like to know. But a lot of times when actors give you direction, it's because they want you to do something that helps them in the scene. And it's not your scene partner's job to make things easier for you, or vice versa. You know, it's like in terms of like character wise, it's like you want to work well together, but it's like, sometimes they say like, you know what, like if you wait a bit, then I can get that laugh. And it's like, well, you know, but I do. I think that's an incredibly important thing for me. It's to not gauge it on laughs. Yeah.
I've got two more questions for you, and then I want to open it up. What role would you love to play right now?
You know, a lot of actors have like ideas of like, I want to play these roles, but I've never been like that. I think it's partly because I'm not coming from classical stuff. I think it's mostly classical actors who know like, well, I want to play, you know, Romeo and then Hamlet and then. You know, all the other roles.
Scottish.
Yeah, and I never thought that way. I've always just been like, well, that's what comes along. I mean, you know, I say yes to like pretty much any job that comes along.
And the last question, Josh, what aspect of yourself, to your surprise, has become more accessible?
What aspect of myself has become more accessible?
To your surprise.
To whom? To
To you. To you.
It's like accessible to me as an actor.
Yes, an aspect of yourself. Yes, that surprises you now, or that it's just become more accessible than it was.
I think patience and understanding. I think I used to become. I think I like if I was working with an actor and they like went up or did something different that threw me. I think I would get if they weren't giving me what I wanted, basically, I would get very
I'd be like, oh, they're not, like, I can't work with them. And they threw off my line or my train of thought, or they messed up my timing, so I didn't get that laugh. And I used to get, I have all this internal, like, oh. And then I worked with an actress, a wonderful actress named Eileen Heckert.
Oh, God.
You know, who was, she's, no one knows who she is, but she was like one of the great character actresses. And she actually, she won an Oscar and a Tony.
That voice.
And I worked with her when she was at the end of her life in the play about, and she had her character, Kenny Lonergan play called The Waverly Gallery, in which she played a woman who had Alzheimer's. Mm-hmm. And she was at the end of her life. And she had these speeches that were all non sequiturs, impossible for anyone to memorize, especially for her. And she would go up every night in different places.
Right.
And then it always been like my pet, like things that I was just too nervous on stage to like be able to go with that. I was always like, wait, you like, you went up and now it's thrown everything off. And by being with her on stage every night, and she would just go up and get, and doing that every night, and being like, oh, grandma, weren't you about to mention Uncle Louie's barbershop? And, you know, and it really broke something in me that, and now it's like pretty most things can happen on stage. And I'm like, you know, okay, let's go with it. And I think a lot of that too is also having kids.
I was going to say.
And having the patience of just like, you know, not being able to, not that they rarely do what you want them to do.
Right.
So
you're not in control.
You sort of get out of that headspace. Right. But also it's that thing, Declan Donnellan has a book called The Actor and the Target. And one of the things he said, it's like, and obviously other people say this too, but it's like, it's, if you're in a place where you're, when you're, if you're being judgmental or thinking about what the actor is doing, and you're in a place where you can even be capable of commenting on it, it's like you're not in the right headspace for what you need to be doing as an actor, where you should be. It's like, and I feel like I wasted way too much time sort of like thinking what they are doing, you know, and like how they're not doing what I want to do, or how they, I think they're doing something wrong, and instead of just working, instead of working off them, or just doing what I, you know,
think you're gonna
or
direct?
Just thinking about what I'm doing. No.
You're not going to direct.
Two things. Well, one is actually, for me personally, trying to get off book so that I can spend more time in rehearsal and thinking about other stuff. But obviously, that's a very divisive thing. A lot of actors would like rather, you know, they think that would... Cause some people, I think, feel like they're going to get set in line readings, which I realize after a while that's not... I don't have a problem. I mean, if I'm able to be flexible once I realize. It's like I don't get set in line readings, you know. And the other thing... This is more just a life thing too, but I think especially for it works for me in acting is meditating, having ideas come up from the subconscious, mm-hmm. unconscious, and I often find that.
Do you meditate?
I try to. It's a lot harder with kids.
Okay, you know, imagine.
But I used to meditate a lot more, I find I meditate more when I'm working because I find that a really useful way for I find like a lot of my best ideas or come up in that way when you're not trying to like when you're not looking at the script trying to figure it out, you know. Mm-hmm. I can't think of anything else really. I'm always it's really just time. I mean, I wish there was more rehearsal time for film and TV, and there's just not. So it's all about that, you know, trying to be in the moment and think of it. I do find it does help me if I think about film and TV as like as every take as a rehearsal, and not like the be all and end all performance thing. And that helps me try to stay loose, that circumvent a little bit about like skipping the rehearsal process. You know, just think of it as rehearsal. Yeah. Well, those are two different things. I mean, one, doing things in rep, I think, is fantastic, and it's so sad that people don't get to do it anymore because it's a wonderful way for actors. You know, I mean, the whole system, I mean, Britain still has it to a certain degree, but nowhere near what it used to be. It was, right. You know, is doing a ton of plays, just doing them, and with, you know, playing small roles and big roles and watching other people learning from them, and, you know, and doing them in rep so that, you know, because they all influence and marinate with each other. And I would love to do more plays in rep. I think it's incredible. I mean, if you ever have experience to do it, like, I mean, I guess in summer stock sometimes people do that, but even then it's not really, you're sort of doing them one after the other.
Right.
And in terms of different countries, absolutely people reacted differently.
Like in the best audiences in terms of response was in Spain, oddly enough. Mm. They were like, I've never felt more like a rock star than like doing a Shakespeare play in Spain. They were like, woo! Like at the stage door, they were like, I felt like Aerosmith or something. You know? And then in Germany, we did it in Germany, and silence. I remember Sam Shepard said, what's the opposite of comedy? Germany. Because they sit there and not literally. And this is Winter's Tale, which is, you know, it has all this kind of like rambunctious like right. stuff that, and if it doesn't get laughs, it's like feel eggier. And nothing, just quiet. Oh. And they were like, they hate it. They hate it. And then at the end, like a 10-minute standing ovation of like, you know, we were like, this is terrifying. And then England is different. I mean, first of all, I think, you know, British people watching Americans do Shakespeare, they're like, oh, please. They're just, like, you know, I remember being sure not to read reviews. And for that, and then sitting in an office one day of something else and flipping through a magazine that had nothing, it wasn't a theater magazine, no reviews, but there happened to be a review in that. And I was like, oh, before I could even realize what it was, I just saw the words, Hamilton, incomprehensible. And I was like, oh God.
You know, I hate to stop, but there's class that's starting any minute. Yeah. Thank you so much.
Absolutely.